Okay, this is the January 4th meeting of the Conway Board of Selectmen. The meeting is being taped by Frontier Community Access Television for viewing by residents and the public and in the future. Is there anybody else recording the meeting tonight? No? Okay. All right, first item on the agenda is the minutes for the 28th, December 28th, 2016. Have you looked over the minutes?
Yeah.
Any additions or amendments?
All right.
All set? All right, I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes for the 28th. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Meetings attended by select board members since our last meeting? No? Okay.
Vacation week last week.
Yeah, it hasn't been a meeting week. We have any citizens' concerns? No citizens' concerns? Okay. Next item is the housing committee. Ladies, you're on.
Tenacious, aren't we?
Yes, you are. Yep.
All right, so we're here to ask that you help us bring forward the intent to purchase of the Sheehan property at 201 Maple Street, which includes this farmhouse and a barn and 4 acres. We drew up the application for the intent to purchase, and then included 7 contingencies. So it's pretty, it's a sturdy offer that the Sheehans are aware of all the contingencies. Mm-hmm. Jody Schwartz is representing them, and she's worked very diligently with us. She's very cooperatively trying to make this happen. The property has been taken off the market after Christmas, and she's not likely to put it on the market again until I think the beginning of April. So that took some urgency away from us, because mm-hmm. we were kind of breathlessly saying, how do you buy this? You know, the town has to approve, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. So that's helped us a bit. But the contingencies, the most critical one is the first one, which is that it has to be perk tested for the number of units that we're interested in. Mm-hmm. And so it would all be a moot point if that doesn't happen. But we do have the Board of Health and an engineer and John Cocott prepared to do the perk test.
Okay, and town council is guiding you through this process?
Very definitely. So Tom put us with him. He was very responsive quickly. We told him there was a time factor. And he had some concerns about certain requirements about going out for bid. When a town makes a purchase like this, you have to show that you tried to find other pieces. But Donna was very helpful in helping him and all of us understand that because it's community preservation money, that there's an exemption. But the town council looked that over and felt satisfied by that. Okay. So he feels all right. We changed the text a little bit on the 7 mm-hmm. contingencies.
Mm-hmm. He's reviewed those as well.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, with the community preservation funds,
yes,
there are going to be certain restrictions on that. They're going to limit you in some way, correct?
The limits are around that it's for affordable units. Mm-hmm. But we're looking also at the aspect that the community preservation committee really covers 3 areas, which is affordable housing, open space, and historic preservation. Mm-hmm. So it allowed us to think of it in a new way that we could ask really to cover all 3 of those, the purchase by them, because we would be restoring a barn and we'd mm-hmm. be securing open space land. We don't intend to build on all 4 acres. We want to preserve as much of the land as we can. The units we envision would be kind of blended in with the barn, blended in with the footprint of the pre-existing house, which is a teardown. Mm-hmm. The foundation isn't even valid, but it would be a similar footprint. So again, we would be conservative about how much land we would use. So, you know, until all these little pieces go forward, we then go to one of the contingencies is that the CPA feels comfortable with this process. And then, of course, that would require that the town say that that's okay.
Right. Okay. So ultimately, we would have to have a voted town meeting,
absolutely,
whether it's a special town meeting or the annual town meeting.
Right. Hopefully, it could be done in the special town meeting.
Have you discussed this at all with the CPA committee?
Don is on.
I'm on that committee, and I have informed a couple of members, the chair, and I thought there were co-chairs. I found out that it's actually just one chair, but they both know that this might be coming forward. Mm-hmm. I have not received any feedback on that. And really, until we get the perk test done, we can't go in front of them.
So, is there a date on that?
We're waiting for your signature, the warrant for the additional $1,000 that has to accompany the intent to purchase, which is in our budget. It was CPA money given to us a year or two ago. Mm-hmm. So hopefully that warrant could be done at your next meeting, as I understand, on the 9th.
All I need is a vendor name.
A vendor name.
Somebody to make the $1,000 check out to.
Sure, makes sense. Is that a, let me check with Joni, whether it's her name or the Sheehan's.
Because it will go into escrow, that's involved.
Okay. Is that a refundable or non-refundable deposit?
It's refundable contingent on contingencies.
Yeah. What you've got that the one contingency for the perking of 12 units. What are your next two strongest contingencies?
CPA.
The CPA, for sure.
Funding.
Okay.
And then we want to get it appraised.
Yes,
we have to make sure that it has that value.
Right.
So that would be high. Okay. The planning and zoning. We're going to go to the planning board to discuss the zoning changes that would be required. Also,
what zoning changes would be required?
Because it's a multiple unit dwelling, we don't have a place for that.
So we don't have an existing bylaw that allows multifamily
right.
housing.
Okay.
So we're talking with the planning board about two different ways of going. One would be a 40B, what's called 40B, it's a comprehensive permit, which is allowable if a certain percentage of the units are affordable, which is our intent.
Right.
So that would be one possible way to go. The other one would be some sort of a zoning that would allow that kind of senior housing. But we haven't spoken directly with them.
No, they've invited us to a meeting.
We're scheduled to meet with them.
Okay, what kind of control would we have over who moves into this housing?
Again, we often refer to the fact that we're using the West Hampton Woods as our template. And we keep going back to them and saying, how did you do this? How did you do that? We can say preference to residents of Conway and people who work in Conway. We are open to the fair housing laws, so still govern. Mm-hmm.
Right.
But preference can be given to residents of the town.
So if you had 12 units and you had 24 people from Conway who wanted to move into those units,
right.
you could have all of them for Conway residents, correct?
Well, we would have
we'd have
preference.
To have a lottery.
If we had.
Yeah, but right. but if you had 24 people interested in 12 units,
I'm sorry,
that
yes.
came from Conway,
yeah, absolutely,
they would all go to people from Conway,
yes.
right? So we would have that kind of control over yeah. over that development.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I don't know if we can also add if you have a family member from Conway, because there's been some interest in people that would like to bring an elderly couple, parents or single, you know, elderly parent, to be able to come to. This complex too.
Yeah, that's been my experience.
It's
either going to be people who live in the community or people who have really strong family ties.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because that's.
So that's still to be determined.
Yeah.
So it looks like you have this pretty tightly tied up in terms of your progress and what needs to be done for ultimate approval. So
and
what you need for
the big
from
one
us
is
tonight.
The developer.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. What you need from us tonight is basically approval for that intent purchase and also the name of someone to put on the check.
Right.
Okay.
Now there's an actual signature on that intent to purchase. And who signs that?
Okay.
John could sign that as the okay. or the board as a whole, depending on how many signature lines there are.
There's one, I believe.
So that would also then come Monday.
Okay. All right, so I'll get you a name. I'll ask Joni.
Because the $1,000 would just be on the vendor warrant.
Right, mm-hmm. yeah.
The actual signing of the intent to purchase would be a separate agenda item.
Well, we were yeah. hoping that the approval of that could happen this evening.
Do we have the document?
I gave it to you last.
And you don't have the
the intent to purchase?
The intent to purchase.
Oh.
I can.
And that wasn't in the yellow folder.
Excuse me.
I can scamper home.
What will the warrant article look like?
You mean the warrant article to pay the $1,000?
No, the warrant article that
for
would be
town
in town meeting.
Meeting.
Oh, for town meeting.
You know, next spring.
It would authorize the allocation of CPA purchased property.
We've had to go before them before to get money to, you know, move along, like the survey we did and the consultants we did. But they're, you know, we have to do some good work to let people know what this all involves.
I have the addendum.
I thought I handed you a copy and said, would you make a copy of it? And then you, as I was heading out the door.
Oh.
It's a pretty boilerplate document. The main part that we've been so interested in is the contingencies, which are the meat of the document. The rest of it's just pretty standard.
I thought that was for after we provided the $1,000. It won't do any good until we have the $1,000 anyway. So,
do you need that document to show someone?
No,
right now?
No, because it has to accompany the $1,000.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. So we can do that Monday.
Okay.
As well.
Okay, and I'll make sure I get a copy to you too.
Yeah.
Okay.
And any other questions? As I say, I think you've got this tied up pretty well in terms of the process you've followed and the restrictions that are put on it, so that basically you can't do anything without the PERC test.
No.
Can't do anything without CPA approval. Can't
wetlands.
Do anything without town vote.
Yeah, we have wetlands delineation yet to do. We have Emily Stockman prepared to come.
Okay.
And she's used in the GIS.
So the conservation
stuff.
Committee is involved.
Yep.
I would ask Tom could get us a copy of that the three board members could review before Monday night's vote.
The contingencies.
We can do that.
And Bobby, there's another one your name came up with, which was hazardous waste. If you have any knowledge of there ever having been like a tank on that property.
My knowledge has never been on.
And how does one test for?
They did at one time had a above ground oil tank, skid tank, I think they had Fred Parker used to years ago,
mm-hmm.
that sat inside the barn. But that was, I believe that was above ground sitting on a skid.
Oh, okay. And I don't recall seeing one in the barn.
Yeah, I don't either.
So it may have been removed.
And do we have to do tests for hazardous waste? Do you do some kind of boring or? I mean, in that it's been a farm a long time that came up for us.
I don't know how to address that.
All right, well, our
do you
first
have to do some sort of. Do you have to do some sort of soil test? Because
sure.
It was an agricultural farm at one time?
Our biggest concern was the tank, and our thought was to ask you if you had the
to my knowledge
of the history of
there was
the
nothing ever permitted through the fire department.
Okay.
But that doesn't mean that there you wouldn't stumble onto something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, years ago, a lot of permitting was never done in town anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. And if there's any more you can think of, you know, this was a...
If there's any further concerns, because I can't be here on Monday evening.
Well, you might want to, I don't know who you're going to question about that, whether you need to take soil samples because of an agricultural farm or not.
I'm not sure we have to.
It was the tank was our biggest concern.
I don't think we have to unless there's some reason.
Well, you got to drill a well.
That, you know.
What are you going to do for a well down there? Drive one, right?
Yeah.
Or drill one.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. It could come up during there, right.
Okay. So
I think the intent of the board would certainly favor what
you're
doing.
Mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. So I'll get the paperwork signed up for
and,
you.
And
do you want, I'll attach the addendum as well.
Yeah, well, I have what you emailed me, so if that's good.
Okay. You've got that one.
I do have that.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. And we'll sign the document on Monday.
Okay. What time Monday? Do you want me to be here?
Is a 6 o'clock meeting good for everybody?
I believe we have an executive session scheduled for 6 on this coming Monday.
That's right. Okay.
So
okay.
7?
So 7.
Yep. It's fine.
And
seven.
It's over there, isn't it?
Yes.
Tom. Yes.
It's at the town hall.
Yeah, because
okay.
We'll be meeting at 7:30 with the finance.
So we're going to have the executive session here and then meet over there. Okay.
Okay.
That's good.
Okay.
Sounds like this is really happening.
We'll see how the PERC test.
Yeah, well,
challenges ahead.
Uh-huh.
We'll see if
the
owners. Oh, yeah. No, there always is. We'll see if the owners will sign it. I mean,
But this is really new ground now. I mean, pushing it ahead.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Bob and Tom were there the first time I saw it, too, and we all felt like it was a good option. I like the location.
Pretty location.
It's a pretty location, yeah, very
looks
nice.
Looks down into the hollow.
And it feels good not to disturb pristine land, which is always an issue for people. It's already been built on. Mm-hmm. The neighborhood recognizes that there's buildings. We tried to keep them similar architecture, so it wouldn't be too
They're all going to be a one-story building, aren't they?
That's right, mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Well, I think you guys are, doing a great job.
Thanks. Thank you.
And thanks for coming
moving
in.
Moving along. Thank you.
Good seeing you. Happy New Year. Happy New Year.
Come home. I see you next Monday.
Yeah.
Not come on. Okay.
Yeah.
6 Ron, p.m.
here.
You're up.
6 p.m.
here? 6 p.m.
here.
Shelly's over there.
So about Chapter 90. Okay. Update on plans for work. Okay, what do we have?
Well, first one is for South Ashfield Road and Williamsburg Road, which is what I would like to do is micro mill it so that we can put lay a new overlay on it before the surface, before the road gets real bad over there.
How much of a surface are you going to put on?
We're going to mill it for leveling, and then we'll put an inch and a half overlay on that.
Okay.
And total was estimated is $143,260.70.
For how much for length of what?
It's 8,500 feet long. Town of Williamsburg did a micro ceiling on their road down there. Mm-hmm. And it's a little bit cheaper. It's a 3/8 slurry mix or whatever that they spread on it.
On the surface? 3/8 of an inch?
It's only 3/8. It's a very high asphalt content to it. And after looking at this, because I talked to the guy about, you know, the process and stuff, and I decided that for a few thousand dollars more, I'm better off doing it this way.
Yeah, 3/8 of an inch.
Yeah.
Not much wear surface on it, is there?
Yeah.
No. And theirs isn't holding up?
No, they just did it. But it's a lot of bumps in it. It doesn't smooth anything out, so any imperfections are, you still notice it because it's such a thin layer, that kind of thing. So that's what that one is.
Okay, any questions? Any other questions on this?
Well, before we vote, we should hear his whole package, I think. And one of my questions to him is going to be is how much does he have account for everything altogether.
What's your next one?
Next one is for East Guinea Road. And that's for full depth reclamation, fund grading and compaction with calcium, and then a 2.5-inch dense binder course. And that one is 660 feet long, 22 feet wide. We're also going to do some drainage in that before we...
Is that extending it any... just redoing what's paved now?
Just redoing what's paved.
Not extending up the hill any further now.
How much does that cost?
Oh, that one was $158,197.60.
Okay.
That's the two projects.
That's a much more serious rebuild.
It's like...
That hasn't been rebuilt
since they redid it.
Long before I came there.
Right. Oh, wow.
So you're talking $300,000, yes. Basically. Yeah.
And after these two, and the other one that you just signed for the engineering, is a little over $100,000. It would still be in the account. I had the numbers, I forgot to bring them down, but it's a little, maybe on like $120,000 left.
Okay. Any other questions for Ron?
I do. And it's going to relate to the Stellar Avenue project.
Okay, anything on these?
Well, I'm just concerned what we're going to do about that, whether we're going to have enough money to do something up there. If we spend it all here and... I don't know. We got any cost estimates on that other Avenue project?
Yeah, it was around $300,000.
$300,000. What if that silly grant doesn't come through? Then what are we going to do?
But the Delabar Ave isn't, even according to the engineer, it's not an issue for the road. It's the slope that, yes, it comes up to the road, but it's not, the road isn't, because of the way the soils are, the road isn't in serious danger of anything making it cave in or.
But if we don't get a grant, the town's going to have to fund the bank erosion problem, correct?
Well, we could do, we wouldn't have to be as extensive as what the engineer's doing for the grant. I mean, there could be more of what we already did to secure the bank there.
Now, is that Chapter 90 money that would be used for that?
No, we've applied for a FEMA grant, right?
Yeah.
You wouldn't be using Chapter 90 money for the slope?
No.
Could you use Chapter 90 money for the slope?
I don't know if we could, because I think it's not considered road construction or road repairing.
Yeah, and it is only a 75% grant, so we would have to come up with 25% to fund the rest of it.
Now, that's, you reapplied the second time on the grant?
But that's not Chapter 90 money.
No.
The only thing that would be Chapter 90 money would be any of the road surface that we would use.
Anything to do with the actual road itself.
Right.
And the road itself is stable. What's not stable is the bank.
Right, we understand that.
Yeah.
Okay. And you've reapplied for that grant?
Yeah, haven't heard back.
Haven't heard back yet. Okay.
And I think that it's relatively unlikely that we'll get in on this round, because the first round was already, they already spent most of the money, almost all of the money. So I think only a couple more projects are going to get funded out of what they have left. But it sets us up for next year, and we already answered the questions that they had about it for this year. So what held us up the first time was that they had questions in the initial round and said, well, we're not going to fund it because we have these questions about it. Well, now we've answered those questions for the second round, so when we resubmit it next year, it'll be...
Did the engineer from the three had look at that? Ask, did he explain to you tell you that the condition it's in right now is stable enough to last another year?
Yeah, he said that there's really no threat to the road because of the way.
If the bank keeps eroding more and more and more, eventually will be a threat to the road, right?
No, I don't think so. It's the bank.
Well, we've done everything we can do right now. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
If we get another Irene, the bank will erode to an extent to which it will affect.
Well, my concern was I don't want to have something happen down the road, whether it's an Irene or whatever the heck it might be, and have to come back to the taxpayers and say, folks, we got to come up with $500,000 to remedy this project. Where are we getting it from?
So where are we getting the $300,000 from?
Well, I know. I'm just saying. But
I mean, at this point, we've secured as much as possible without increasing the bank. There is still a couple sections there that we still may lose a little bit because of the way the trees are on the bank in that section. It's already been filled. Talking to Russ French, that's already been filled years ago. He told me that they dumped a bunch, and I'm sure that that's the stuff that's sliding down the bank now. But the actual soils that are under the road, the layers, are real stable soils. Mm-hmm. It's just what started it all was the weight of the trees. When the tree fell down, it just took the whole slope with it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not so much the actual soils for the bases, and it's just the topsoil, basically, that went down.
And right, so we're essentially in a position now where we've done everything we can do. Okay, the engineer says we're okay for right now.
Mm-hmm.
The money for the slope doesn't come out of Chapter 90 anyway.
Correct.
It has to come from a grant, or we have to do something else.
Right.
But for right now, we're okay. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
And the FEMA grant will be next year?
We'll reapply?
If we get it next year.
We'll reapply, yeah.
There's no danger to public safety right now?
No, actually, we put a bunch of Jersey barriers up along where it was close to the edge of the road.
How about up above the building there?
We bermed that.
North or west of the building? Put some berm in it, did you or something?
We put a bunch, we made a berm to keep the water from falling, you know, running down there.
Well, has there somebody going up over that little bit of berm and going down over the embankment? But I mean, it was always open there, but.
What's that?
Well, up above the north of the, north or east of the existing riverbank building that sits there.
Yes, we did a bunch of work there.
Safe enough that nobody's going to.
Yeah. That one's not a huge issue there because it's not super close to the road there and all these. I mean, the bank slides more. We've had an issue though with somebody throwing brush over the culvert pipe that's there and plugging that up, and I'm not sure where that stuff is coming from, but. That would be the only huge threat that I could see is if something happened like that where that culvert pipe wasn't able to handle the water.
And ultimately, we will want to work with the Conservation Commission to trim out trees that get to a certain size so that if any tree does go over, it won't pull as much dirt.
Sure. Okay. All right. Any other questions on these two projects?
When did the tree go down in the process?
It was after Irene. It was 2.5 years ago when the first time the first section went.
Yeah. Okay.
Any other questions on these? Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve both these Chapter 90 projects, one for South Asheville Road and the other for East Guinea Road. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Roads are expensive.
Yeah, they are.
In most all of my projects that I do with Chapter 90 money, the only money I'm spending is the major cost. We still do a bunch of other stuff.
All the stuff yourselves.
That comes out of my normal budget. You know, like after you pave, you got to do the edges and stuff. That's all. We just try to make it.
Yeah, so that extra money funds the work that you guys do?
Same under the duly authorized?
Yeah.
That comes out of your budget.
What happens to the leftover
everybody,
money?
We usually have everybody sign.
There's no leftover money.
Oh, there isn't?
No. Far.
I thought that was, he was saying there'd be some money left over.
No. I only use the money for the major expenses.
I see, yeah.
But long term, we get about a third of the money that's really required to keep all of the town roads in the best shape for Chapter 90.
Sure.
And that's $250,000-$300,000 a year.
Did we get
from Chapter 90?
$276,000
this year.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
I'll make copies of these and give it to Tom.
Ron, while you're here, we're going to take something out of order. Concerns of the selectmen. You have something?
Ron, I have a very serious concern, being the selectman and his fire chief, that you're not keeping our water hole opened up down on the grit pile. And if we have to get, for some unforeseen reason, get a fire truck in to get water, that's our only area in the center of town to get any water from the river.
I apologize for that.
And if we get stuck in there trying to get in there, that's going to kill the whole fire.
I apologize. It's not done intentionally.
It needs to be done after every stinking
storm.
Yes, stone.
I know.
What is it that you have to do?
Just plow it out so that they can get down.
Just deepen it a little bit, right?
No, you just have to make it that so we can pull out
just make sure it's accessible
to the water hole.
I will make sure that we.
I see.
Okay. And I apologize.
We'll correct that for the future. Okay.
I'm very concerned about that because that's our only supply in the whole center town.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'm glad to see water in there again.
Thank you, Ron.
Thank you. Happy New Year, all.
Yeah, happy New Year to you.
Thank you.
All right, next item on the agenda is to approve the community development strategy for the community development block grant application.
This is, again, you got it last time, got it again for this time, and all we need is a formal vote on this now. We did go over it.
Yeah, Joe Markazian helped us with this, and I think he did a great job on it.
Yes, he did. Yeah. He was a good asset to that.
Yes, excellent job on this. Another thing that FERCOG helps us with, and I think this is very comprehensive, and I think, any questions on it, Bob? Do you have any questions?
He's good, no.
Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve the community development strategy for the community development block grant application. Now, do we need a different date on this, or is this okay, this date?
We will change, we did change it at one point. I think this must be the older document.
Okay.
It should say 2017.
Yeah, okay, great. Can we get a second and a?
A second.
Okay, we're all set then, okay. All right, Tom, we've got some budgets available.
Yeah. Also noting that we can discuss some of these with the Finance Committee next week. They had asked for four in particular, police, fire, Board of Health, and Treasurer, which I think Treasurer-Collector would be good. And I guess we don't have a Treasurer budget now, but their budget is going down. The first thing that I'd like is you to look at this sheet, which is a list of all of the budgets proposed that are either proposed for level funding or going down. So I thought it was something of an impressive list. So just so you know, these things are going out. Unfortunately, today, after I printed these out, I talked with Roy, and he has a recommendation for enhancing some of our email service that he thinks is necessary, especially given the changes in the public records law. Yeah,
that's certainly one budget that is tough to keep level funded.
Well, once we get the subscription in, this will be an annual subscription. It changes the cost of some of our email accounts so that we have, I think, 12 accounts will be affected. For all of them, it'll be $1,800 for the year. Mm-hmm. So each one of them is $100 change for the year, more than what we're paying now, in order to get the ability to, for example, retrieve deleted emails and things like that.
So what's going to be costing us $1,800 more a year than we're paying now?
Yes. We have 12 of them on a very inexpensive plan. And they'll go up to about $25.
Is that going to raise the whole account higher?
Yes, by $1,800. Yes.
Because I know you said it was going to save us money a couple weeks ago.
The phone is going to save us money. The phone change will. There are things that that are going to be saved. That's still in under town administrator right now. So, police. Level funded, fire, up just $717.
Mm-hmm. That was only went up because of the fire, and only went up because of the
radio
47% fees. Increase in our radio fees to the council governments.
There's some real
discussions going on about that. I bet.
Yeah, there's some real problems with the whole county communication system, which is going to cost all the towns more money in communication. There's going to have to be a replacement of radios very shortly because there's going to be a change in frequencies. So there's going to be a lot of expense involved in that. So that's not something we have a whole lot of control over.
And that's not factored into the budget at all now?
Yeah. Well, it's. It's not in this budget.
I mean, this is saying 70 bucks or 90 bucks.
It's 47% increase, if I may speak.
Yeah, really?
I think it's just to maintain the system, to keep it operational at this point.
Right.
Until some changes can be made.
Yeah.
And the changes are going to be extensive and very costly. What's happening at FERCOG is they're attempting to get a grant that comes under Homeland Security to make major renovations and upgrades to that system. And if they can do that, then it'll be fine. There won't be a lot of cost to the towns. If they can't, they're looking at other alternatives to do some long-term funding for that, so that it doesn't impact all at one time.
Yeah.
But it's an essential system that is, because it's older, there's a lot of things failing in the system.
Yeah, and I see it's going downhill fast.
There are some new changes in federal regulations because of, again, security purposes of communications that is going to add to cost. So it's a major problem at this point, but the FERCOG is doing everything they can to work it out. I'm on the finance committee at FERCOG, so we deal with this at virtually at every meeting to figure out how to keep the cost down.
And as I'm sure Bob remembers, it wasn't that long ago, but before, when there wasn't any countywide communication system.
Right.
Use smoke signals at the time.
I don't want to talk about that.
And the COG was instrumental in getting the first system in place.
We had a Homeland Security grant for that, too.
Yeah. So it's...
But there was, what's that, 12 years ago?
I believe it might have been 15 years ago.
And so this is the first major upgrade in quite a while.
Yes.
So that's that. And
again, that not only affects fire, but it affects police and ambulance as well.
Right. So that's also reflected in the police budget. I misspoke when I said it was level funded. It goes up, but also because of the radio fees. Yeah. The ambulance, the major addition to
training.
Is the policy that the director and assistant director came in and explained earlier, paying for people's training up front and then requiring them to pay it back if they had not.
That's a license exam fee.
They didn't do it. Yeah, that's.
Well, they anticipate
that's the rise there.
Probably 60 EMTs might be willing to do that. Maybe 5 or 6 EMTs.
Well, it's going up.
I mean, that's
6,500.
Only that's only in anticipation that they can get more EMTs to take the exam.
That's true.
Right.
That's true. Yeah. Well, they have to plan for that.
Yep.
And I'm going to check with them to see whether or not they had understood radio fees going up, because I believe they pay the same radio fees.
No, I...
Do they?
No, I think the fire... I could be wrong when I'm saying this. I think the fire department pays for both of them.
Well, they do have... Oh, radios. That's just the hardware. Okay.
I think I pay all the radio fees.
Okay, yeah. This looks just like hardware.
I think Kenny and I split it. Please pay their share. I pay the fire ambulance share.
Yeah, okay. Okay, that's good.
But I'm pretty sure that's right.
That's very helpful. And emergency management is level funded. So that takes, this is all of public safety as a category. Well, excluding the dog warden.
We recommended an increase.
And the tree warden. Yes, and the dog warden needs an increase tremendously, and the tree warden, I think the budget doubles from about $300 to $600 in order to allow him to go to the annual conference.
Right.
And have mileage for that as well. So those do go up. Then I also wanted to bring your attention to this really fairly substantial reworking of Article 2. The main thing that I did was to, for the departments, split out salaries from the operating expenses. Mm-hmm. And that is a good budget practice. Mm-hmm. It prevents accidentally overspending on operations and then not having enough money to pay salaries, which is illegal. And mm-hmm. not that it ever would be done intentionally, but we don't ever want to be in a situation where it can happen. Mm-hmm. So having those as two separate lines is considered a best budgetary practice.
Fine.
Now, I actually also did it for the dog and tree wardens and emergency management. Those are stipends, and I'd actually like to bring that back in. I have not separated out stipends. Those are paid completely separately. And
sure.
I didn't want to get into that at this point. I don't think it's necessary at this point.
Yeah.
We'll see how it goes. But I did want to do it for the major departments.
May I suggest that you'd also do it for the ambulance department? That you haven't?
Well, ambulance I have not split out because we pay only a portion of their budget anyway.
Yeah, the rest.
So that's all internal to their budget.
Yeah. But they do pay salaries.
Yes, but they don't pay it out of the 15th. The
salaries
way that
are
we
not
funded,
in this 15,000.
Yes, they're in.
It's the fifth.
In Article 2, we give them $15,000, which is a supplement to their internal. They're almost an enterprise fund.
Sure.
If they got an extra $15,000 a year, they could exist.
What does the enterprise fund pay for?
Everything.
Everything else. The only thing we contribute to the ambulance is that $15,000 a year. And then they are self-funding based on the fees that they collect.
And that's from insurance that they charge when people have insurance, things like that.
Oh, yes.
Wouldn't you
that's
pay,
the revenue.
The revenue,
wouldn't
yeah.
You
yeah.
Pay, the, wouldn't the, you pay the ambulance wages out of this top line item instead of the other one, just in case for some reason enough funds didn't come in the course of the year to offset the difference?
We could deal with this fund too.
Yeah, we could deal with this in many ways. All of their if you take the director, assistant director, clerk, and hourly employees, or the EMTs, mm-hmm. that comes to $18,686 a year. And we have, because we haven't broken that, I mean, we could consider that for the future, but we have not, because we haven't broken that out, the $15,000 that they have been funded at mm-hmm. forever would not cover that.
Okay.
And I'm happy to take a look at how to address that for the future. I do want to continue refining this. Right now, what we give them
well,
would
I guess
not
my question here would be this. I would think that out of that $15,000 ambulance department salary, it would should have another line item that would say salaries, just say salaries for the fixed salary people, like the ambulance director.
Yeah, but that doesn't come out of this. Those don't come out of this Article 2. Comes out of their own fund.
Well, what does Article 2 contribute?
It's mixed. Article 2 gives a town subsidy to the ambulance department, which otherwise relies on the billing for services. So typically, we've chipped in $15,000.
And that's a timing issue, too. We do that at the beginning.
Yeah.
And they may or may not spend all of that.
That's right.
Just like all the other town departments.
Well, and you can look at the budget versus expended here. You know, we certainly want to give them more than they spend.
Right.
And if they, this money reverts back to the, no, only this money reverts back to the general fund. The rest we put into stabilization for them.
Right. Yeah.
So, which is in preparation for their next ambulance. So the ambulance funding is a little bit differently.
It is, yeah.
Yeah.
As a separate piece. But I do appreciate the suggestion, and I am interested in refining this whole model.
A little more difficult refining now that it's been there.
So,
but some of the salary is fixed, and some of it is variable.
Fixed. Right. Some is variable. Yeah. On call.
We could do that in a separate area if you want, but it would be on.
And it is part of the budget that we use to create the town budget. So at least we know what the intent is there.
Yeah.
So what that did was it created a whole lot of extra lines, and I said, well, is there any way I can save space? And it also, I think, makes it easier for some departments, like treasurer collector, if we treat it as the whole department that it is. For instance, the assistant treasurer collector is paid both as a tax collector and as an assistant treasurer.
Mm-hmm.
So this makes it a little bit clearer what's being spent on operations and salaries within that department.
Sure.
As a whole, rather than having to add up things from two different budgets. So this is for 145 and 146.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I've included that and reworked the figures to make that show.
Mm-hmm.
The same, I've done that for registrars and elections. Similar functions, both of them relatively low figures. It makes sense to have them be one line item that gets voted on.
Absolutely.
But this first year we do this in town meeting,
I would very much appreciate the opportunity to explain this.
Great.
To people.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Absolutely.
There'll be questions, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Anybody who does a budget, even if they do it at home, is going to understand that.
And the same for the 170 series is sort of the environmental series. Mm-hmm. Conservation Commission, Planning Board, ZBA, Agriculture Commission, Open Space, they're all 171, 172, 173.
Yeah.
And they all come up under $5,000 total.
Mm-hmm.
So, my intent is just to bundle things together that make sense to be bundled and that don't involve a lot of money. Going down the next one, the 290 series, the dog and tree wardens and emergency management. They're all under 290. It's under $5,000.
Yeah.
And again, a little bit over if I bring the salaries back up. And they're not salaries, they're stipends. So again, I'd like to I'd like to revert on that one and not break out the salaries.
Yeah, I don't think you have to.
On the 540 series, human services, they're related budgetarily. The vast majority of that is veterans. The Council on Aging is $400.
That's right.
So being able to explain that verbally, I think, should be sufficient for most people. That keeps the sort of size of Article 2 similar, while being able to break out the salaries. And we have all of these individual sheets for all of the individual departments. We know what they're supposed to be doing, so we'll know if there's any budgetary problem that comes out of it.
Sure.
This is a more convenient way to budget, to present it,
sure,
and to vote it.
Yeah.
So I've also sent this on to the Finance Committee, and I hope next week also to present this to them as a proposed reworking of Article 2.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know what Nick usually does at town meeting is he takes everything together,
gotcha,
and then he does separately the school budgets.
And I had that as a second question, whether or not to bring
you
this
move
out.
The, move the two,
as,
the two down?
As Article 2A, B, C, and D, and do those the way he votes them so that he doesn't have to
jump around. People confused.
Do you think that would make sense?
I would think so.
Or you could just move the school, the numbers, all the way down to the bottom. So when he goes, he says, okay, we're going to do everything.
Yeah. Well, he takes four votes.
Yeah.
And if I could
talk to them about it.
I would love to do that.
Yeah. Okay.
I think it would make it
a lot. I
would
think it would make a lot less confusing to townspeople too if they were all in one location.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do the schools have to be 300?
Like
they are now? So those numbers are assigned.
Yeah, we're not changing those numbers.
those are state numbers.
Yeah.
There's the reason even to include them here is to help people think in terms of how the state has laid things out. And this is how it lays it out, which is why it's been laid out that way. But if we're not going to vote it that way, then it makes more sense to have Article 2A, B, C, and D, and have those four votes as Nick usually takes them.
Talk to Nick, see what he wants to do.
Great, thank you.
Okay. All right, it looks like everybody's getting their budgets in on time, and things are progressing very nicely.
Yeah, I'm missing just a few now.
Mostly the small ones?
All the external ones. So, schools, COG, insurance.
Well, school, you're not going to get school for a while.
Employee costs, we're not going to know until we know health costs. Mm. So those things are external to the town, and I won't get them in until mid-February, probably.
You don't have a number on health insurance yet?
No. We'll get that from Maya. We get that from the... Hampshire County.
Yeah,
I don't have that.
They went up about 6%.
Oh, okay.
6%. They haven't had an increase in 4 or 5 years, so that comes out to a little over 1% a year.
I know they went up 6.8 last year, but I hadn't heard anything for this year, so.
Yeah. So just file that. Till we get the real number.
Yeah. I anticipate it to be about the same as it was last year myself.
All right, so you're satisfied with the way this is progressing?
Yes.
Looks great.
I'll just bring other budgets forward as requested by the Select Board and the Finance Committee. Again, okay. I'm hoping to meet I believe we're going to be set to meet with
next week.
Finance Committee at 7:30 over there.
Okay.
As a joint meeting.
Okay.
And that's specifically for police, fire, Board of Health, and what was the fourth one I mentioned? There was a fourth one.
Dog officers.
The more general questions of how does Article 2 look and that sort of thing. Oh, treasurer and tax collector.
Right.
That was the other one.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Any new business? Doesn't look like it. Okay. Thank you, Tom. Any items not anticipated 48 hours in advance of the meeting? Doesn't look like it.
I don't have anything.
Any other updates, Tom?
Just a few. For committees... despite the lack of bids for the wastewater system engineering project, the wastewater committee still hopes that a bid is forthcoming from Tie and Bond. Apparently, there was a communications gap within the company as to who would be filing the bid. They did intend to bid on it, and apparently we're going to be able to, because nobody else bid on it, we're able to go back to them directly and say, if you'd like to bid on it, we'd like you to.
Was there any problem with the specs? How come nobody bid?
Well, Andrea Woods at the COG called people up, and there was one company that just decided it wasn't interested, probably because it's a small job. Tie and Bond, they have a couple of different people who do small jobs, and there was the lack of communication between them. They actually had intended to bid. So she was expecting two bids, at least. And one of them just decided it wasn't going to file. And it's hard to say exactly why. But
if we get only one bid,
speculation is because it was too small.
Do we have to rebid?
No. And we're doing everything we can to get a bid.
Yeah.
So that's that. More later, I guess. The Capital Improvement Planning Committee is meeting Tuesday to consider three requests. come from me to partially pave the back parking lot for the town office building, and two from the highway department, one for a hydraulic boom and one for a grader. I had mentioned that to you before. The real news here is that the committee is meeting on Tuesday at 6:30 here.
Is one of the select board members supposed to be on that committee?
Yes, Bob was actually appointed May 31st, and apparently we just didn't tell Dana. So we're going to make sure.
Dana didn't seem to know who anybody was.
Yeah, and I've let him know that
I talked to Tom about it today.
That so, Bob's your uncle, so to speak.
Good. That'll stop the confusion.
So I'll go.
Thank you.
Good.
For departments, we have some news from the Conway Grammar School. The lead and copper analysis report for the drinking water samples collected on December 1st, 2016, as part of the MassDEP UMass Assistance Program for lead in school drinking water for the Conway Grammar School, had one sample result that exceeded the action level for lead in the school's drinking water at one location, a water bubbler in room B17, a sixth grade classroom, a first draw of water. The second draw sample taken after flushing this fixture met the requirements. For now, the cold water valve to the sink has been closed and its handle removed. The bubbler has been labeled do not use due to a lead test that exceeded DEP action levels. All of the other 50 or more samples taken at the school were satisfactory. The final run of piping to the faucet that tested okay and this bubbler is copper. Bob Lesko will have the bubbler and any attached fittings replaced and will work with DEP to retest this location and comply with any associated requirements, which will include notifications to the school community and other interested stakeholders.
So obviously it was just a problem with that particular
and piece of equipment. Only for the first draw, but we're doing everything right by the book.
Fine. Okay.
Also, I am trying to get a handle on town Facebook pages. We now have pages for emergency management, fire, highway, parks, recreation, and trails, and the town as a whole. I hadn't really been aware of some of those before.
And
now I am. From what
do you know
I
who manages
see.
It?
Well, I've seen that Adam has posted to the
fire departments.
To his fire.
Doing the fire departments.
Michelle's doing highways. Dave Chichester's doing emergency management. Parks, recreation, and trails. Heidi is currently the admin, but the chair has also requested to be an admin on that. And the town as a whole, I've sent a request into Facebook to say, hey, this is us. We'd like to register as the people who use this. It, you know, they will automatically set up pages. And there's a
question.
There's a question that comes up, and it says, is this your business? Yes, this is my business. I clicked on it and it said, well, you know, tell us who you are and how to get in touch with you, and we'll get back within 48 hours. So I expect that will happen.
So will these Facebook pages all come in under the auspices of the town of Conway? Mm-hmm. Is it grouped when they're all said and done? Or how do
They're certainly separate pages. It would. Dave Chichester especially is interested in some pages liking the other pages so that when a post, for instance, appears on the emergency management page, it will also appear at least on the highway page.
Exactly.
And perhaps the fire page.
Yes.
So it helps to have that kind of coordination.
Yeah.
At this point, you know, a lot of towns get all upset about social media policies. And my inclination is to be watchful, but I don't see the need for any particular, you know, this is how everything has to be done kind of approach right now. You know, there larger towns have problems with people, you know, making inappropriate posts and things like that. I didn't see any of that on any of the town's pages. So my inclination is that until we have a problem, we just monitor it and maybe have something in our back pocket that if we need to say, okay, this is how we handle this situation, we're ready to
do that. We just have to limit who can post on the page and let those people know, you know, what the rules are. And that's all we need to do.
Especially, I agree with John, especially being in the town departments.
Perhaps slightly more nuanced than that, but that's the general idea. For the highway department right now, no one's allowed to post on it except the admin. So it's just pushing information out. They're directed to the town website, I believe, or they should be, or I requested this, that they be directed to the town website to make any comments. Mm-hmm. That way, all the comments can come in. I get all the comments, and I think Lisa gets the comments, too. And
you approve them before they get posted, or you just, you can...
That is... I think for the general town website, anybody can put a comment in. They might have to have liked the page first.
But not moderated or something like that. You don't moderate them.
I have had occasions when I've had to moderate them, and I'm not sure if that's really true for all of them or not. I'll have to look at that. But often they're simply requests for information, and I can deal with them immediately without having to post it and then answer it on the book. It's just, you know, I'm looking for, you know, this or that, the historical people or something like that. So that hasn't really been an issue for me either. So I think it's fine the way it is now. We just have to be aware of what is out there. Mm-hmm.
Does Roy have any experience in social media that he can help us with?
I don't know, but I have stacks of social media policies from various towns if we need to.
Okay. I'm not necessarily things. Talking about policy, but practicality of putting these things together. And
I don't know. Okay. There are people who know a lot about Facebook who don't know a lot about anything else, and vice versa.
Sure. Yeah. Okay. Well,
but we'll Michelle on Highway certainly knows a lot now. Okay. Anyway.
All right. Thanks, Tom.
Sure.
All right. In the mail, we got our beacons.
Yeah.
Except for Bob, for some reason, unless it's put in his home mail. And this issue is all about the Massachusetts Municipal Association annual meeting and trade show on the 20th and 21st of this month. I will be there. I will also be installed as a member of the board of MMA at the meeting for District 1. We got a letter from Talmadge. They're a Massachusetts municipal tax lien investment company. I would pass this along to Jan. There seems to be some information she might be interested in on that. Okay. There's a municipal actions on marijuana legalization being given by the FERCOG on Thursday, January 12th. I'm not sure how time sensitive this is, because I think this was scheduled before the legislature said nothing's going to happen until 2018. So I don't know how relevant that is.
So should we find out whether that's been canceled?
As far as I know, it's still on.
Happening?
Yeah. Yeah. We got the quarterly Barker newsletter, Barker, from Franklin County Sheriff's Office Regional Dog Shelter. Very interesting information in here, if anybody wants to read that. This might be one of those interesting things to put up on our webpage, a webpage.
We could, well, I'm
Put a link to this if they have this up on their,
exactly.
on their site. Because there's a lot of good information for people who have dogs. And that's about it for mail.
List of bad foods for your dog. Oh my God.
Yeah.
Marijuana is bad for your dog. I didn't know that.
Absolutely.
That's
I got to stop giving it to my dog.
Stop giving it to your dog.
Or the bears.
Okay. Any announcements? We do have one thing to sign here. Richard Pollitt. He was approved as a member of the 250th anniversary committee, and we never signed this, but we did
approve it, right?
We did approve it.
Yeah. Okay. So really, that should have just been in your personal file. We didn't. Yeah. That's not really select board. It's been done.
It's
Thank
done.
You.
Okay.
Did another one below that, John?
What's that?
Pages here.
No, that's just for Bob Armstrong on his appointment to the Capital Improvements Planning Committee. Okay, we just did a duplicate just in case.
Oh,
he needs
we
to
thought
be
we might
sworn
have to
in.
You've been I'll have to come. I'll have to
you
come.
You got sworn in.
You have to get sworn in.
Sworn at? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Our next meeting is going to be at 7:00. Next Monday in the town hall, but before that, we're going to have an executive session here at 6:00.
Okay.
Okay. Any other business to come before the board? Okay. If not, I'll make a motion that we adjourn. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.